Good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining Craft Beer Blab. My name is Gunnar Soros, and my co-host to the, I think he's this way, maybe he's this way, I don't know. He's over here somewhere, Jonah DiPasquale, on Blab as The Hoggle, but everywhere else as Jonah DiPasquale. Check him out on Twitter, Instagram, anywhere else. And he also hosts a great show every Thursday night, Bike Chat. Pretty exciting stuff. Looks like we have Bike Gab on Bike Chat this Thursday. Talk about their Kickstarter campaign and cool, leather bags that they look really cool. So I'm kind of excited about this show. Thank you guys, everyone, for tweeting this out. I will give everyone on here right now a little heads up. So we're going to be giving away a pair of Twin Six Surly Brewing branded socks. Now, everyone that tweets this out will get an entry into a drawing to get these socks. So Jojo Keys, Jim, I think Dan, you already got your tweet in, I think. Yep, I seen that you got that in earlier. Anyone who tweets this out during the show will get an entry into it. Then there's two other ways that you can get an entry, and that is, one, join the Facebook group, and I'll put the link right here. If you're not already a member, so anyone that's a new member to the Facebook group starting today will be entered into the drawing. And then the other way is to join the Craft Lab mailing list. And don't be afraid. I'm not going to spam you every day with messages on, you know, multi-level marketing or anything like that. Basically, it's just a way to connect. And hopefully, if we get a following, I'll be sending out emails every week. Just kind of a reminder, hey, the show's on tonight. And possibly, I would love to spam you with more beer. You know, there hasn't been a way to get beer through email yet. So.
Cooking supplies, guys. Remember, it's cooking supplies.
Yeah, if you do send beer through the mail, you call it cooking supplies. So, again, telling people about this throughout the show so that everyone can share out the and get an entry in. We'll put everybody into a spreadsheet. I'll use random.org to randomly generate a number of however many people do this, and somebody will get it. And we'll announce that next week. And so you got to come back and find out if you won. But yeah, we got, today's an exciting show. Hop Slam. So Hop Slam is a great beer. I don't know. And to be honest, I haven't tried this year's one. This is my first taste of it this year. Nice. I have had it in the past. I try to get it every year, last 4 or 5 years. Oh yeah, you can smell the hops right out of the can.
There goes the glass pour.
There we go.
Look at the head on that,
yeah. Dude. Don't let Eric see that, boy. He'd run you right over the coals. That was like a five head right there.
Yeah, it's about three, maybe four. It's you know, I tend to pour aggressively. I like I like to release all the aromatics into the foam.
There you go. Here's the proper pour.
Yeah, that's more of a proper pour. That's awesome. So now, Hop Slam, one of the things that probably makes, I mean, besides it being a good beer, is that it's extremely limited in availability. So it comes out every year around this time, February.
Okay.
You know, you can get it for maybe 2 weeks out of the year.
Well, one of my questions to you is, what is it with the timing? That was the one thing that I was thinking about. Why February? Do we get that? Because that's one of the things, honestly, when I was doing research, I couldn't figure out why February was the month.
Right.
Don't know.
I have no idea. That would be something we should contact Bell's about and see. Because that's a really good question. Because, yeah, why February?
We're going to have to do that. I'm on a mission.
Dan K says he went to 4 different liquor stores and he finally found it.
Nice. I know. Wow. I know, right? And it's funny because, and I know, Gunnar, you were like right in the middle of something. Dan, you are not alone. Gunnar, two of the main craft beer warehouses that I called were completely out of this beer. And I like literally remember I called you in a panic and I said that I was not going to be able to get it. And my wife the other night sends me out on some errands and I'm at like this mega super mart, which is a little bit of a catch 22. And like literally I see this massive Bell's Brewery display. I'm actually like almost literally crashed the shopping cart. So it made it into the shopping cart. So anyway, so cool. So February, Bell's decides to bring out Hop Slam. And now tell us a little bit more. It's a unique blend. There's something special in this and it's not the essence of THC. What is it?
No, well, it's extremely hoppy, but they brew it with honey. Which is, I don't know if it's odd, but it's definitely something that they do. You know, one thing with brewing with honey, so much of the sugar gets fermented out that it shouldn't add very much sweetness to it. In fact, it should actually kind of make it more of a dry beer. Right. But yep. Some of that honey, I don't know, flavor, I guess,
right,
should kind of stay behind. So, that and then the however they brew it,
right,
and then just the way that they hop it, I mean, that is what really makes this beer, is the hop presence,
right?
I can't remember, I think they use like 6 different hops. Dan K says you can just taste quality. That is so very true,
right? No, I agree with that for sure.
No, so yeah, definitely worth the wait, worth the extra. You know, it's not an inexpensive beer either. It's kind of up there as far as price for a 6-pack, but definitely.
So indie. We are so indie. I mean, like literally, I tell you, Dan, I'm gonna get a wig for next beer blab, and I'm gonna have a man bun. I feel naked.
Yeah. You're going to do the Rush Miller, right? Just get a nice Afro wig going. And
Afro wig going.
That would be awesome. That would definitely be awesome.
Yeah, he put on an Afro wig a few weeks ago in a different blab. It was pretty comical.
I did see that. Yes, he's got a number of different characters like Gunnar does. Hey, Nicole, Woody, what's going on? Thanks for tuning in. Good to see you.
I was just gonna say, hey Nicole.
I saw Nicole. She jumped in. Good to see you. I see she was. She must have had a fantastic Super Bowl. I don't know if you saw some of the tweets she was putting out. I think I have to say it wasn't even like a package good effort. It was an arsenal.
Oh, yeah, that was quite a bit of beer there,
dude. Seriously, she got stocked up. So the brewing process in terms of the honey, and again, it's deceiving because anytime you say there's honey in a beer or beverage, people, it gets misconceived. And I find it to be very, you know, a very complimenting option to an IPA. Because, you know, sometimes when people say IPAs, oh, I like IPAs, and then I know that it seems to me, Dan, I don't know, or audience, if you guys would agree, there's been this trend with just like massive hop. To the point where it's almost over the top,
right?
And I feel like there's definitely a tolerance where you push the envelope with flavor and taste. Now this is a different envelope because it takes something of a traditional norm of a hop and an IPA, and then complements it with the honey. And I think it's phenomenal because to me, you know, man, it's a shame it's seasonal because I would, you know, man, I think this would be, without question, I don't know about you guys, but man, this would be my go-to beer. I mean, it's awesome. I mean, by the way, it's the first time, Dan, have you tried this before?
As a matter of fact, I have tried it before. And I've got a picture to show you on my phone because I had some friends over for mixed martial arts fights prior to the Super Bowl on Saturday night.
Nice.
And I had 3 6-packs of Hop Slam in my fridge at that night, and two in the fridge and one in the freezer. There's a 6-pack of Hop Slam in the freezer with 1 chilling, nice. And then an opened one and another one in the fridge. It's a little blurry picture, but
we can see it.
I was a little bit worried. We ended up drinking it all by a Super Bowl. So I was like, son of a bitch. Yeah. And thankfully, the liquor store close to me still had a few left.
Oh my! I know, right? And it's funny. It's funny because what's the window? Because I know that a couple of the packaged good places that I talked to, I think it's like one more round of shipments, maybe, that I understand. Because I mean, obviously, it's you know, I would imagine everybody is going nuts to get it back into their stores as well. So recession improvement from last week is probably Dan, are you comparing last week's show to this week's show? Is that what you're going on?
Last week, this one probably won't be beat, huh?
The window
of opportunity, I would say, if you don't get yours in the first week, you run the risk of not getting it.
Oh yeah, no, I agree with that.
I think part of the reason why, when I went to the store today and saw a big stack of it, was because we had kind of that big snowstorm last week,
right?
And then, fortunately, people that then went to the store to stock up for Super Bowl maybe didn't pick Hop Slam as their choice. You know, again, it's a little pricier than some other choices. So, you know, to pick up a case of it to share out with your buddies, maybe, you know, Dan Blumberg, he had the right idea where he did it.
Right.
But for a lot of people, it's going to be, you know, I could buy probably a case of Busch Light for the amount that I can buy a 6-pack of Hop Slam. And all my buddies can have that as much as they want. So I'll save the Hop Slam for myself.
Yeah, cool.
I talked to my distributor, and Bell's will be in Louisiana in the next few months. Oh, nice. Excellent. Look for a Two Hearted. That's always a good one.
Yeah.
I doubt you'll be able to get Hop Slam at that time, but Two Hearted is a really excellent IPA.
Yeah, I agree there.
And I would like to bring this up. You guys are talking about the honey and the high hopped, the double hopped type beers being potentially overdone. We have a new brewery in the Twin Cities called Lake Monster Brewing.
Nice.
Out of St. Paul, excuse me, as I'm burping from the beer.
You can't do that.
I picked up a growler of Lake Monster Double IPA.
Oh my God, it's fantastic. Pour that through the monitor, please. I'd like to hear you.
Fill it right here. This right into the webcam, right?
Fill it up right there. You got it. It's fantastic.
It's a similar beer. I wouldn't put it on the quality of Hop Slam. The Hop Slam, I think, beats it out. But, and that may be the honey. That's what I'm trying to say. It could be the honey that's given it a little sweeter taste and not so hoppy. That sweetness and sugar, I think, cuts down on the hoppiness a little bit.
Absolutely. I totally agree with that. And I'd said that before. In fact, if I remember correctly, I think the first really distinct, almost hoppy, bitter beer that I had was Red Hook. Man, has anybody in the audience had Red Hook? Dan, you have Red Hook? Man, that stuff. Dan, how about you, Gunner? Have you tried Red Hook? You know, Red Hook. It's like a steel toe boot to the face. I mean, if you're not expecting like that bitter taste, it was rough. I mean, I think that probably after probably having said the word probably a million times, but I think after having a few attempts at tasting that, I liked it. But I think to Dan's point about this being on a whole different level, the honey really is you know, without question the reason why. I think that if you have not tried it, you know, certainly don't sweat it. But if not, there are a number of local pubs and breweries that do have it on tap. And I know that if you go to their site, I was on their site just a few minutes ago, you can go to their beer finder tab and I'll share that with you in just a second so you can find local places that actually do distribute it as well. Oh, yeah, there you go, Red Oak.
Yep. There you go, beer finder.
Now, the other thing about Hauptslam, though, is that it's a double IPA, so it's got a higher ABV. You know, it comes in at 10%, so I think it's well hidden with the hop and the honey balance. Oh, yeah. So it
absolutely
it doesn't come across as, you know, it's not like one of those hot mouth feels where it feels like it's burning in your mouth.
Right.
It's got a really good balance. I mean, it drinks more like a regular IPA. So that can be good and bad because it is dangerous. I mean, you have more than one and you start to feel it.
Yeah, that was that was one of the things that we talked about in a few earlier shows. If you watch the replay, I don't know if you guys remember, we did the kind of like when Star Wars was coming out, the Imperial Stouts, man, those things, good lord, it's like an anvil hits you on the head and you know it. I mean, but again, we're talking about a completely darker bodied beer. And this is, you know, as you can see, obviously, from everybody's glass, I mean, it definitely is not a very, dark beer by any means. Again, to your point, I find it to be very smooth to the palate. No, zero bitterness at all. And it is interesting, by the way, they do sell it in just six packs. Where does that mean? Is that for a reason? I don't know.
Well, you know what? You can, I don't know, I have not been able to find it here, but they also sell, it's like a mini keg. Bells puts out these mini kegs.
Oh, that would be fantastic.
The size, but I mean, those would be the best way to get
without question.
People. Hey, real fast, let me tell people, go ahead and tell the bird, because we got some cool things going on when you do that. When you share, you will be entered into a drawing to win a pair of Thoroughly Brewing socks made by Twin Six. So that's one way that you can get an entry in. The other is to sign up for our newsletter.
Yeah, please do that.
Yeah, let me get the link for that in there.
And while Gunner's doing that, listen, the real reason why we're trying to do this is because we want to keep the craft beer community informed. Obviously, we love having you on the show. Also, too, the Facebook page is another great way to keep in touch with us. And also, there's a couple things we are playing around with for some concepts. I know that, for example, Anello and I have done kind of some beer swap programs where he sent me some beers that I'm not able to get in Minnesota, like Surly, for example. I sent him a sixer of some local beers. And by the way, Dan, I don't whatever that monster is. Yeah, there you go. And I love Dan. Yeah, exactly. You know, Dan, let's definitely connect, because I'd like to do a beer swap with you. But seriously though, I think that's the fun of craft beer in the community. As I said, just to kind of help each other out. And I think that is the fun of really being able to enjoy craft beer, especially beers that are not available in your area. But to your point about for the Facebook growler swap, exactly. Yeah, that's a pretty big cooking supply mailer. I don't know about that, but the good news about being on the Facebook page or the group, it's a private group, so we'll obviously be able to include some closed dialogue and banter, but also to the important thing, as myself being a co-host of the show, anything that we can do to help better tweak and make the show more enjoyable and easier for you guys to tune in as well, that would be great. Just a side note, Jonah has been audio for only a while. All right, well, let me, can you see me, Dan? Can you guys see me?
I've been able to see you, but your audio is broken up. I mean, not completely, but you kind of broke up and got a little electronica there for a little bit, but you seem to be okay now.
All right, let me, Hannah, I'm going to refresh really quick.
Okay. So Bell's also puts out a great, I think, I want to say it's a seasonal, kind of like this, called the Oracle. Let me see if I can find it. And I've only had that once. That's another double IPA, but it is limited. Here's the
test. 1, 2, 3.
I hear you just fine.
Awesome. Yeah.
Much better, Joan.
Yeah, I know. It's weird. Blab has been doing some really crazy things over the past couple weeks. Anyway, sorry. All right, I'm back. Gunner, you actually just have to put those back on again for our viewer audience. I just want to bring something to their attention. I don't know whether this is intentional. Is that the sticker that was on them when you actually bought those? Because that's some major cheese going on, dude. That's some crazy stuff. Anyway, sorry.
I got these from work for some reason. They mailed it. So I work from home, but I actually work for a company. And so for some reason, they sent out these glasses at the beginning of the new year with no explanation. They just showed up in the mail from work. And I was like, okay, well, I got some sunglasses, but I didn't bother to take the sticker off. I just figured out.
Look at Dan. He's the dedication. That's, look at him. What's he doing? This is good.
He's going to switch glasses too.
Nice. Are those the Google Glass prototypes? Is that what you got going on?
If you don't mind, I'll plug my wife's place of work or business.
Totally. Go for it.
Both of these glasses, the ones I was wearing and the ones I just put on, are from a company in Minneapolis called iBobs. They make reader glasses. However, mine, you can get your prescription lens put in them. So these both have prescription lenses. These are like a modified, they've got the glare. You can see the reflective kind of surface where you can't see my eyes, but they're also prescription glasses as well. And if you haven't heard of them and you need glasses or like need readers, check out iBobs for sure. They're awesome. I love their glasses.
Is this the right thing? iBobs.com. Yeah. Jonah got the link and I got the link in there.
We are all over it. iBobs. Very, very cool. Very cool. Nice. Wear the pants and the glasses. Wow. That's fantastic. Nice job. So, you know, again, I think the reality of it is, do you guys feel that craft brewers are strategically launching these seasonal beers to be more advantageous for? I don't know if that's okay. There you go. I don't know. Do you guys feel like these breweries do this on purpose to help kind of create vibrato and excitement, or it is what it is? You know what I mean? Gunner, by the way, folks, if you guys are following a very cool app, by the way, is Untappd, and I'm on Untappd. You guys can follow me. I follow Gunner. I follow Dan. But anyway, Gunner, by the way, very low grades on the Jenny Bock, my friend. It was like a 3.5. So clearly that brew did not knock your socks off. So this is a total segue, by the way, guys.
My rating system, a 3 is solid. 4 is kind of exceptional, and 5 has to be like off the charts. I mean,
gotcha.
Probably give this year's Hot Slam a 5. Most family beers that I really love, we get a 5. A solid, which is one of my favorite beers, right. It's a kind of a go to.
Sure.
That gets a solid 3.5. It's a solid, good drinking beer.
Yeah.
So, me, 3 is actually really good. Now, when it goes below 3, then that's when you got to be like, oh, well, that's not really good.
Right.
But excellent. Since he's a bit liberal on his ratings on Untappd.
Gotcha. So, yeah, right. Yeah, it's funny, by the way. If you guys have checked in on again Untappd, apparently there's a Mardi Gras badge that you guys are getting. I tapped in earlier. I logged in a beer earlier today, and I think you get the Mardi Gras badge. So, no idea what that means. Apparently, is it Mardi Gras? Did I miss something?
No, it's not Mardi Gras right yet. I don't think.
Well, I know, but if you go, but guys, if you go to the Fat Tuesday. There you go. Red Flag Dan says Fat Tuesday. I'm sorry. Sorry. There you go. I was gonna say. Thank you. Let's see here. Who's still in here? Hey Dan. Thanks for the kudos. Thanks for joining in. Good to see you. Appreciate your time as always. And man, Hop Slam is just killing. This stuff is great. I'm a little worried that I'm probably not gonna be able to get a second round, but hopefully I'll go back to my mega store and stock up. Gunnar, you were a trooper. I checked in earlier and I was like shouting out tweets on Untappd that I was drinking something. Gunnar's like, oh, I can't believe you're doing this to me.
Great. Because I wanted to specifically wait until the show to have my first taste. And then I was like, oh, no, maybe I just got to taste it. And then I'm like, no. I'm going to hold out. I'm going to wait. I'll do it on Tuesday.
Oh, yeah. And I think the problem with this beer is it's so damn good that you know, literally they're almost like the joke is like they're Doritos crunch all you like will make more. I mean that without question. I mean, I clearly, you know, could probably go for another couple two tree and then some. But mind you, being a Tuesday night, we need to be functional on Wednesday. And that's almost, you know, by the way, that's kind of the irony of craft beer lab. It's almost like Friday on Tuesday. Is that fair to say? Because
I don't think there's a rule around that, Jonah. I don't think you have to be cognizant on Wednesday if you don't want to be.
I think you're right. And you know, by the way, you know what? I want to put in a request for eye bobs that have like eyes that make me look like I'm awake. So I could put the eye bobs on and they're like, yeah, Jonah's like totally awake. And I could be like at my like cubicle or desk just completely clocking Z. So
I'll talk to my wife about it. See what they can do.
There's my product request there, or just actually get eyeballs tattooed on the outside of my eyelids.
That wouldn't be very fun.
No, definitely not. I think that would probably hurt. Hey, so two people missing at large tonight. If you guys want to give like the craft beer blab of shame, like there's no showing from Tommy Crowder. I did talk to him earlier today. It's at Tommy_Crowder. Where are you? And of course, Eric Rush Miller, guy just is periscoping like a madman about flying in a freaking helicopter, which is great.
Right.
And could not find Hopslam. Gunner hogged it all. Oh no. So Red Flag Dead, you didn't get any? Is that what's going on? Oh man, what a bummer. Hey Red Flag Dead, by the way, we do have a seat open. I got a couple questions for you. Oh, you did get it or no? Oh, you didn't. Okay. Couple questions. Hey Gunner, you know, I don't think I realized this the other day. I'm sitting here following Dan. I'm going, did we ever ask him what the significance of what Red Flag Dan was all about? I was thinking that the other day. I mean, these are the things that I lose sleep over, by the way, in case you guys are wondering. No, I know you really don't care.
If he's not gonna get on, let's theorize. I think it may be a challenge flag. Maybe he's a big NFL fan.
Okay, maybe.
Red flag.
And you know what's going to happen? We're going to egg him, and he's going to see that open seat, and he's just going to know that he's going to need to come in and like defend why he's Red Flag Dan. But he's probably not, because he's going to sit back and probably troll and say, I'm not coming in because I know they're going to rip me. They're going to rip me. Nah. He's all, we're good. It's all good. So hey.
Well, one thing that I can tell you, Red Flag Dan, is that Andy's Crossroad, they had a huge stack of it there today, so you still have a chance. If you get there soon, you can go and get a six pack.
Yeah,
I'm gonna do a pour of Smash Project Long Trail.
Ooh, nice, man.
I didn't clean out my glass.
Now, Dan, have you do you have access to any of the Long Trail brews at all? By the way.
Long Trail Brews?
No. Long Trail Ale?
I don't think I've heard of that. No.
Well, no. That's the second batch that Gunner has. The first they do, that's the second run. The first one they do is a single malt, which I mean that stuff is it's awesome. I was the single malt I was drinking. Gunner's like, oh my god, that stuff's great. Send it to me. And then by the time I actually went back to the packaged goods stores, they had that Project Smash. So I don't know. I think I might be able to find it. I will do my best to hit up my local package store that has that. And Dan, make sure that you DM me your contact information offline, because I definitely want to do a beer swap with you. That'd be awesome, because I think I'd like to try some of the beers that you, there you go. Thanks. Yeah. There it is. The Long Trail Beer Finder.
Yeah.
So now Gunner, let me ask you me this: what's your palate experiencing now going from Hopslam to the Long Trail Project Smash?
Well, you know, this Long Trail Project Smash, they're using Mosaic hops, and it's a 6.8 ABV, 52 IBUs, and Maris Otter malt. So Smash, I don't know if anyone knows what Smash means. So in brewer's terms, it means single malt and single hopped beer. And so in this particular beer, they're using Maris Otter English malt and then Mosaic hops specifically only right, for this beer. Right.
That's interesting. My guess would have been sour mash, but...
No. I know. And that's exactly, you know, it's funny you said that. That's exactly what I thought when I tried it, and I was like, oh, this is going to be nasty. And it was not at all. I was really surprised. In fact, I would say that beer that Gunnar's drinking is definitely a solid go-to for sure. I don't know. Would you agree? Yeah. You could probably drink that pretty regularly.
I could probably drink it regularly. It does, you know, coming right off of Hopslam, then you notice that it, I don't know if it's the Mosaic hops, but there's definitely more of a, I want to call it a dankness to it, you know, kind of that resiny taste to it. Not that that's bad. It's a good thing. But it's different. So, you know, Hopslam, they use a combination of different hops, as well as probably different malts in it. And so they're really going for different balance and stuff. Whereas using a single malt and single hop, you can kind of, you got to refill there, Dan.
that's not a problem.
With a single malt, single hop, you're showcasing just one malt and one hop. And so a great way to kind of get to know what different hops taste like.
Yeah,
I see Leland Best is in the house. Thank you so much for joining in.
And actually, hey, listen, audience, a milestone for Leland. It was his 100th day on the lab. So if you see Leland right now, right there, I'm giving him a little heart, giving him some shout out. So, hey, great job, Leland. And by the way, Leland also part of Blab Nation. Him and Jonathan Trapp, those guys do a show every day about 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. I try to catch it, but very informative. Talking about a lot of different principles and concepts around marketing and things like that. So check them out at Blab Nation. So Leland Bass, there he is. Hey, by the way, folks, you are watching Craft Beer Blabs. It's Tuesday. My name is Joe DiBiscoglia. I'm the co-host, of course, host of the most, Gunnar Soros. And please share this out. Let your folks know everything in craft beer related. Tonight, very exclusive. We're talking about Hopslam. This is a great beer produced by Bell's Brewery. And now Gunnar actually has a pair of socks. We are going to be doing a giveaway. Two ways that you can get these awesome socks is that you can either subscribe to our newsletter, or you can actually, Gunnar, what is the other one? You can actually subscribe to our Facebook page, right? Correct?
Group, yeah, the Facebook group. Or, and also another entry is to tweet it out. I see Leland told a little bird. So
I think he wants the socks, actually. You know what? Leland's going to like wear the socks, and he's going to actually wear the socks on. Uh-oh, here we go. Elio coming in hot.
Red Flag Dan asked me, no whiskey tonight? No, there will be whiskey tonight. Just not at the moment.
I got to learn how to activate my mic. Can you guys hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Hear
you. Oh, thank God. All right, cool.
I mean,
you're in the dark.
We're going through Mike Envy. I mean, like, clearly my stick mic is no match for Elio's. Elio's got like the Mac Daddy.
Nah,
you need some light there, man. How about some light?
Yeah, here, I got a light right here.
There we go.
What's up, guys?
Oh no, turn it off. No, I'm joking.
what are you guys even talking about? Nah, I want it off though. it's too bright in here. Would you guys?
Beer.
Oh, you guys are drinking beer. That's cool. So, I was just in that Martin Scorelli thing. You guys know him?
No.
You guys don't know Martin Scorelli? I don't know. It's like this whole Illuminati thing. This dude's crazy.
You don't want to get into that pill. It's the pill guy, the guy who's up here.
Yeah. the dude. It's funny. He just loves attention. So it's like, you got to talk.
We don't love attention. Yeah, we just love talking about beer. So, Ilya, what's your favorite craft beer?
I'm a Heineken fan, to be honest.
Oh, yeah, nice.
Heineken. I mean, everybody loves
Heine. Leland Bass loves Heine. Dan loves Heine. Gunnar loves Heine.
Dan Blomberg says no.
You're not a Heine fan?
Not the Heine beer. I'm a Heine fan of women Heines, but...
You say that seriously? All right.
No, yeah. Oh, I guess he left. Oh well.
Too much excitement.
He got offended that Dan and I don't necessarily care for Heinies, but that's okay. I mean, I'll drink them. I mean, just like I'll drink a Coors Light. I mean,
well,
you know.
Well, here's my thing, you know, about that, and actually this got me kind of thinking about something that just happened recently in the Super Bowl commercial, but one of the biggest memories about Heineken is just that ridiculous, like, skunkiness, like, oh my god, like if you guys, like, if I can think of the one beer that I've ever had that has been so ridiculously skunk, no matter whether it's fresh or refrigerated or whatever, it's Heineken, and like, I thought it was me. But, like, my buddy's like, oh, yeah, this is great. It's Heineken. I'm like, God, my dude, this beer is, like, it's skunked. They're like, no, man, this is how it is. And finally, I'm like, I cannot drink this beer. It's like, that is one of the beers, without question, is not on my radar. So, anyway.
Did you see what Dan K said? Open a Miller Lite when you get in the fridge for 6 months and you have Heineken.
Oh, my God, that's fantastic. This is going to be like a mega props button for him. That was funny. It's very true. So did you – two things. Eric, a.k.a. Rush Miller Foundation, pushed out a tweet, and I don't know if you guys caught this. It was like during the kind of like the closing statements, and it was one of the Broncos athletes, I forget the name, excuse me, but anyway, he's just like, oh yeah, I'm gonna go home to celebrate and I'm gonna drink lots of Budweiser beer and stuff like that, and I'm thinking to myself, like, oh my god. So the point that I'm trying to make is, I don't know, I've been harassing Rush Miller and Tommy K all my life. That's beside the point. So listen to me, guys. You gotta remember, if you watch a couple of our shows earlier, we were talking about how Budweiser was making a coup to buy up a good number of craft beer companies, and I think ironically we didn't really cover any of the hot topics. We just really jumped into things. So this may be a random segue, but I noticed when I was paying attention to what was going on. You know, in one sentence, right, they're slamming craft beer, right? And meanwhile, here, guys, I'm sure many of you know this, they own Shock Top, right, as well as a couple other I guess if you want to call them craft beers in their portfolio. And I don't know about you, but I'm thinking to myself, if you're a company that owns other companies, it's like, why are you trying to create a shitstorm with same company that you're owning? And I think as one of my good buddies that I follow on Snapchat said it, he's like, it just, at the end of the day, it just ends up becoming all about money. And I know, Gunnar, you talked about this, and I know we've all said this. It's like, you know, it's great, you know, we're all celebrating Hop Slam, and you know, who knows, fast forward, it's like, could they be, you know, one of those gooses that gets fattened up for market, and you know, one of the big boys throws them a check, and do they jump at it? I don't know. I just think it's just interesting to see how now all of a sudden, you know, Gunnar, we've been joking about it, Dan. I saw you kind of, you know, you kind of took the worm a little bit. Yeah, exactly. You know, we were kind of joking about indie beer and how craft beer is getting played out. You know, you see me sending out some of my hashtags. I'm like, hashtag indie beer, and I guess it's more of a joke. But the reality of it is, it's just, I think that's where the scope of this industry is going.
Right. Well, and that's kind of a good segue, because I wanted to bring up that indie beer discussion again, because I don't think we kind of gave it enough time last week, only because as I read into it more, so there is a definition for craft beer that is put out by the Brewers Association. And so they define craft beer. However, there's no laws or there's no governing about it. It's just, you know, this small group saying, here, the definition of craft beer. And so you have companies like InBev or Anheuser-Busch InBev, Miller Coors. They're buying up smaller breweries left and right. And so far on some of these breweries, they haven't changed recipes or done too much meta. But are those companies still considered craft beer?
Not at all. Yes, I'd say no.
I would disagree. What? To a point.
To a point, right. Well, and so that's why some people are calling for this name change of indie beer, and they're coming from the music industry where, okay, indie music is an independent label, independent band putting out their own music by themselves without the influence and money of, you know, a large record company like, say, Sony or whatever. Right. They're doing it on their own. So they're independent, which to me sounds pretty good. The only thing in my mind is that I don't know if it's going to get traction. And also, even if you have somebody defining it, there's no rules or regulations that say, you know, Ab InBev buys a brewery. Why can't they call it?
Good. I'm sorry.
They're not fined for it, so I don't know.
Do you mind? I was going to say, do you mind if I give you my reasoning why
I think
they're still considered a craft beer, even though they've been purchased by another larger organization? I work for, right now, a company called Heartland Payment Systems. And this is the third company I've worked for. But where I started was a 120-person small company, a craft business, right? If we take craft beer, it's a small business comparison, right?
Right.
You take that over, and I'm going to be working now for a company that's international in a few months once the transaction closes. But what I do and how I make what I make hasn't changed in 15 years. Now, that's not the case. That's not the case with every craft beer that gets bought out by a Miller Lite or a, you know, Anheuser-Busch or whatnot. That's why I'm saying it's somewhat. Some are still craft beer because they keep that business unit as a separate unit, or that brewery as a separate brewery, and it maintains where they're only brewing the amount of beers that fall with.
Oh, yeah. Well, and I agree. I tend to agree with you. And I also fall back on if the beer is good, ultimately, I don't care if it's owned by Ab InBev. I mean, you know, yeah, I'd rather my money go towards a smaller company. But I don't know. What is one? I think Breckenridge was one that just got bought out by. Breckenridge got bought out by Ab InBev. Yeah, I think that was just in December. So as long as they still put out quality beer, and you know their recipes haven't.
I think one of the things that I can tie an analogy to is the cycling industry. I don't know if you guys know, I was a rep with the Canada Bicycle Corporation prior to them moving the production. Gunner, you can tie into this one. The production of their bicycle frames in the U.S. over to Europe. And, you know, everyone's like, Cannondale, made in America, those kinds of things. You know, one of the reasons I was drawn to becoming a rep with Cannondale, because the bikes were made in the U.S., you know, 36, you know, different hands, frame before it's made, blah, blah, blah. You know, there's just a huge amount of pressure all across the board to stay competitive. Obviously, you've got the big box brands and things like that. But getting my point is that, you know, Cannondale had to do what they had to do to stay healthy, stay viable as a company, and they moved the operations overseas. People still buy Cannondale. People still love Cannondale. It is what it is. Now, getting back to your point, there was there were some comments earlier. I think it was Dan, you know, Dan that kind of threw out Sam Adams. He likes Sam Adams. You know, it is what it is, and he still drinks Sam Adams. I don't mind Sam Adams. I don't hate on Sam Adams. It is what it is. You know, in fact, I don't hate Shock Top. I mean, Shock Top's a Budweiser product. I mean, I don't drink it a lot. It, you know, if somebody, you know, handed me a Shock Top, I'd still drink it. And Dan, I agree with what you're saying, is that, you know, to a certain degree, I think we are so, you know, we're so anal retentive about, like, you know, to your point, Gunner, the indie beer, the craft beer. I mean, you know, you have to realize that most consumers just don't simply give a shit. They're like, oh, this beer tastes good. This beer doesn't taste good. This beer is cheap. This beer is not cheap. And I feel like that, you know, because we are, you know, very myopic and hypersensitive about, oh, well, you know, this is the greatest trendy, you know, seasonal beer. I mean, you know, at the same time, you know, we're becoming the debutantes of hop for crying out loud. You guys can quote me on that, by the way. But hey, listen, I wanted to give a shout out to Marlon. Hey, Marlon, thanks for tuning in. It's great to have you. Appreciate you coming on. Where are you tuning in from?
Thank you. I'm tuning in from Ohio, Youngstown, more specific. And I didn't know exactly what you guys were talking about. I heard the fact that you were talking about commercial beer and some, you know, microbreweries getting bought out, and whether some people kind of think that ruins the quality of the beer and whatnot. And yeah. I think that's a great topic. Great topic. I used to work at there's a really cool shop out here called Vintage Estates, and I used to work there. We sold over 1,200 different kinds of craft beer. We sold over 1,500 different kinds of wine. We also sold a ton of mead. And a ton of scotch and bourbon. It was awesome. Great fucking place.
Bourbon and scotch.
Yeah, bourbon. Right. Scotch. Love scotch, right? I love craft beer. So we're all good there. But like, and then, so this is the first time I'm hearing that actually Breckenridge got bought out. They actually make one of my all-time favorite IPAs, which is the small batch 471. And they just recently put out a dry hopped version that was barrel aged, which if you haven't tried it, it's unbelievable. It's fantastic. And then I know that Goose Island, I want to say, wasn't Goose Island bought out by Anheuser-Busch, if I'm not mistaken?
Yep. Yeah, correct. Exactly. Okay, yes.
So, I mean, that's another thing too. So you look at even the trade value of Goose Island's beer, especially, you know, with the Bourbon County stuff, it's unbelievable. Like, I tried their stuff and it's still great. I don't think, look at these big companies, they want to make money. They see how much the craft beer is affecting their sales. I mean, craft beer just
totally your country,
you know, and they want in on it, man. You know, it's like the craft beer just took off. People started, you know, recognizing quality, and they want that, and they want in on it. I don't think they're wanting to touch anything, you know, like it's kind of like, you know, you don't hear of these microbreweries getting bought out, but then like everyone gets fired and they just put their own people in there. You know, it's like they, you know, you're still able to just function and do your own thing, but we own it though, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. And again, if you just kind of, you know, back up a little bit to what I was talking about with Cannondale, I mean, again, you know, that you know, the buyout of Cannondale moving, you know, their production overseas allowed them to be competitive, to make good product, and still get people to want the same Cannondale brand. And again, you know, you know, Marlon, you brought up a good point, right? Is that, you know, again, for the audience out there, I mean, this is a very tight crowd tonight, which is great because it helps us to get some good dialogue and dynamics going. It without question, this is the Wizard of Oz, and it's the man behind the curtain. I mean, the things that we're talking about, you know, audience, there's no question that the average consumer has no fucking clue. I mean, they're not, you know, to your point, you know, Marlon, respectively, you're like, oh my God, I didn't even know Breckenridge Brewery had gotten bought out. I mean, you know, for Gunner and myself, I mean, we're spending a lot of time, you know, kind of trolling, you know, the airwaves to see these things and to pay attention to what's happening. But, you know, in fact, Candy Bear Ryan, he's not on. He's actually from the Midwest, and he's like right in the heart of it. In fact, it's funny because he was sitting here rattling off a good number of breweries, microbreweries that Gunner and I, you know, had never even heard of. So I think that you know, as this whole indie craft beer phenomenon keeps percolating, I mean, there's always going to be the next new thing. And in fact, I will really put it to you this way: is that remember your local pub or bar or wherever you used to hang out at in college or wherever, you know, you're like, oh, where is it now? I mean, you know, sometimes some of the places that stay, sometimes there's turnovers, whatever. But I think if you think about like microbrews, craft beers, you know, there are beers that without question will come out and they'll kill it. And there'll be, you know, microbreweries and you know, other types of entities that come out that are just like flash in the pan. So I think that to your point about when you see like big box companies such as Budweiser, you know, absorbing these companies. Sure. I mean, you know what, Dan? I think that I have to agree with you, even though I did disagree with you. I think you're right. I think that you know, it does enable them to still keep the integrity of the brand in place. So it's not like, you know, you're not looking at this packaging that says, you know, random indie / craft beer bought out by Budweiser. You know what I mean? And I mean, you know, to your point about Marlin, I guarantee you, you're still going to buy the same good quality Breckenridge Brewery. It's going to be the same packaging, everything about it, the same employees that are making it, the same employees that are bottling it and brewing it. So I think that's a good point, a good comment that you just made. So nice job.
I just want to chime in too on top of that. I think you made a good point too, saying that, you know, if I wasn't here on this conversation, I would have never known, you know, if I obviously, you know, if I don't read about it or anything like that, you know, drinking Breckenridge from here on out, if I didn't read anything about it or, you know, wasn't listening in on this conversation or anything, I probably would have never known that, you know, Breckenridge was bought out either. You know, I think even Lagunitas just did a deal with Heineken where they sold like half of their freaking brewery or something, you know? I mean, and here's the thing, by me saying this too, is I'm not necessarily, you know, condoning just, you know, giving away your brewery to, you know, some major, you know, beer company. But, you know, I prefer personally if they just stayed, you know, do they just own themselves? I mean, but, you know, does that matter? Does it make a huge thing? I don't know what the effects are of that in the long term. I have no idea, you know.
Well, you know, I think if it red flagged Dan, he just said shelf space, you know, and I agree with that, guys. You know, without question, you know, we're talking about our you know, small go-to package stores and this, that, and the other thing, but let's look at it in a big picture perspective. And you know, Marlon, you talked about it, and Dan, you even mentioned it, and I know Gunnar, you did earlier. Is you know, let's face it, guys, cash is king. You know, they looked at, you know, when they bought out Breckenridge Brewery, you know, Ryan, who's not on the scope tonight, he said it best. He's like, you know, oh yeah, Breckenridge Brewery, they're kind of on their way out. And Gunnar are like, what are you talking about? Like, we would kill for Breckenridge Brewery beer. But the fact of the matter is they saw it at an opportunity where, you know, they could sweep it, buy it as you know, as a viable brand where it still has some integrity and build it up. And, you know, I think, you know, you talked about it earlier, is just, you know, building up the brand, crushing the shelf space and getting it out there. So, hey, Eric, what's going on? Good to see you, man. Welcome, welcome, welcome.
Very interesting.
One other point on that topic, Jonah, it's going to be real short, Gunnar, is that if it weren't for some larger parent companies buying out some microbrews, we wouldn't have the multitude of options that we have today because of the distribution that Dan mentioned. That's all I want to say.
Is that true?
Well, and I was going to say that, you know, and this is just what I've read, is that because of the distribution system, so there's three tiers, right? There's the breweries, there's the distributors, and then there's the retailer. And so a lot of the distributors are actually owned by the big beer companies. So AbInBev owns distributors, well, at least here in town, especially. Our two major distributors are Anheuser-Busch and MillerCoors. And so they distribute all the beer that's in our area. So for a retailer, the distributor comes in and says you have to devote so much space to Anheuser-Busch, and then Miller says, you know, you have to devote so much space to Miller. And so even if they had another option to choose from, they wouldn't have very much space to devote to them. So in this case, like what everyone is saying is that this allows for some smaller breweries to have as much shelf space as a lot of the other breweries. Of course, they're not going to get as much as Budweiser, but at least they can compete because they're being distributed or they're owned by Anheuser-Busch. So, you know, I just kind of wanted to get that point in there too. So, and again, like we said, it's ultimately money is king. If I was a brewer and somebody came up and said, here's $1 billion, I would probably sell out and say, here, take half my company or take 49% of my company. I see nothing wrong with that. I mean, you gotta make a living if you can make some bucks in the process. Nicole Whitty says, it is all in what the corporation wants to do with smaller breweries. Do they want to keep the same recipes? Do they want to change the brewing process? If everything stays the same, but money is funneled in to increase distribution, why not? And I think we touched upon that before too. If they're not firing everyone and getting rid of everyone, then all is good because, you know, they're not getting their hands in. But I do fear for when they do, you know, if profits aren't meeting their expectations, do they come in and say, okay, you know, you guys haven't met your quota for this quarter. You guys got to do something. And then all of a sudden they're cutting people and then, you know, they're bringing in more.
So are you for the bigger beer companies buying them out so they can have a wider distribution, or are we, you know, do you have any stance on that?
I wouldn't say I'm for it. I mean, my stance is that I can completely understand and I would probably do it if I was in their shoes. But I wouldn't, I have a hesitation to saying, and, you know, I don't know, Leinekugels is really popular around here. Mm-hmm. I don't drink it because I find it tastes too artificial. They use a lot of artificial ingredients. And so, they're not necessarily a craft beer, even though they could possibly be called a craft, even though they're owned, I think they're owned by Miller. Well, yeah, technically they're craft, but I think they, in the past, I don't know, 10, 15 years, they've taken too much on as far as trying to, you know, their lemon shandies and their raspberry shandies and all that kind of stuff. And then not using real ingredients, using artificial flavors.
Right.
Yeah, it's like, okay, well, obviously, they're trying to make the profit margin for Miller. So the quality kind of goes down. Right, but it's still huge here. I mean,
two things.
In Minnesota still drinking.
No, I want to give a shout out to, we got a VIP in the house, Don DeBrita. Don DeBrita, actually, if you guys are not following him, give him a follow on Snapchat. It's Don DeBrita. And Don actually is all about, he's got a 10,000 member beer club. He works with breweries, bars, and restaurants, and he does some awesome snaps on Snapchat. So it is good. No, Don, seriously, man, you put out some good content. I do enjoy following you, and definitely, I know he and I have played in some, played a little bit of a Snapchat tag trying to connect with each other, but he's definitely a shooter. He's got some fun stuff going on, so give him a follow. So listen, one of the other things too, guys, thanks for tuning in. This is Craft Beer Lab, Thursdays, 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. My name is Johnny Scully. I'm your host, Gunnar Soros. We're here every night, every Thursday night, rather. It would be great every night, but this week's show is exciting. We're talking about Bell's Brewery Hop Slam. Got a lot of great people jumping in and out right now. Currently, Dan is in the house. Thanks, Marlon, for tuning in. Oh, he's going to looks like he's going for a beer break. But, you know, one of the things, and I guess I'll wait till Marlon comes back. Nice. So
I just picked this up tonight. Yeah.
Oh, nice. Look at that Hop Slam glass.
Beautiful.
What a nice topper for the evening.
It is. It was amazing. I was dying to have this year. I had it last year.
So, now I know. Yeah, that's awesome.
One more comment real quick, Jonah, if that's right.
Good.
All right. That loops back around to the whole limited release talk from earlier.
Right, and
I will say it's a massive marketing machine that I totally buy into because it's really good. And I will pay more because it's only released for a couple weeks out of the year. It's not that much better where if it were on the shelves every day for $15.99, I probably wouldn't buy it. But because it's only available for a couple weeks, I'm a sucker and I'm in.
You have to.
You know, there's no question about that. I think the irony there, Dan, you nailed it. Is you know, I could invite you over to my house and I could make you a couple of Folgers of coffee. You'd be like, man, this is delicious coffee. And then at the same token, I could take you out to, you know, the local, you know, gourmet coffee house and buy you coffee. You'd be like, this is delicious. I mean, I think a lot of it is the perception. I mean. About it, I'm 100% agreeance with you as well. And hey, listen, Marlon, I just want to let you know that you are part of the Raz Nation. Nicole Witte is slamming you. She, you know, you may want to make your bed the next time that you do jump on the live stream.
Oh, what did I do? Sorry,
she said you need to make your bed. Just saying.
Oh yeah. Sorry about that. Yeah, it was a rough day today.
nothing goes unnoticed here in Craft Beer Lab. Our audience is brutal.
I'll tell you what, man. That was the least of my worries today. So
no, it's all good.
You guys are making me thirsty. You guys had this.
Oh, I haven't had that.
It's fantastic.
Nice.
That's funny. So at any rate, like I said, I think this is definitely one of those fine lines. And one of the other things, Marlon, I wanted to mention, and Dan, back to kind of your point, bring it back around again, is the other example is Gunnar had mentioned this before. I talked about Magic Hat. You know, Magic Hat, you know, back in the day, you know, I don't know, you guys know I'm an avid snowboarder. We used to go up New England and go snowboarding. And I was like, oh, my God, Magic Hat. And, you know, at that time, I could only get it when I was up in New England or Vermont, respectively. And I think that, you know, now, obviously, they got bought out by the Great American Brewers, whatever it is. Anyway, so now, I mean, you know, whatever. I mean, Magic Hat is available anywhere and everywhere. So I think that, you know, all of a sudden, you know, Dan, to your point, you know, one of the other things you talked about is you talked about the marketing wagon. You talked about those, you know, those cheesy, you know, 12 years of Christmas and the variety pack and all that horseshit. I mean, you know what? I don't buy into that. I really don't. You know, I mean, at one point I was like, oh my God, this is great. You know, like 12 different beers. But, you know, the reality of it is there's probably like three beers you like and the rest of them taste like freaking mule piss. You know what I'm saying? You'd be better, you know, you'd be better off buying a sixer of this that you really wanted. So, I mean, I think to your point, back to the marketing thing, it is a double-edged sword. And I feel like once they get to the point where they've bought the company and they've improved on, you know, the systems and the brewing process and all that crap, they're like, now what? You know, so, I mean, you know, it is something to think about. And you do sometimes, yeah. You know, for example, Saranac here up in upstate New York, I mean, they do the same thing. I mean, Saranac makes great beers, but they cheese it out with these, like, you know, these stupid variety packs, and it just drives me nuts because, you know, they take these, you know, mule piss beers and they put them in these variety packs that nobody wants. Like, oh, here's the, you know, the donkey piss pilsner. It's like, God, I would never buy that. You know what I mean?
Donkey piss and mule piss. That should have its own shelf, like in the store, you know?
Oh, jeez.
I just wanted to mention another point, too. Like, I don't know if this is going to sound – oh, sorry, go ahead.
No. Nicole McWitty makes a point that did somebody actually try mule urine? So that's what it is.
I got to constantly mute my thing because I'm just dying.
Oh my God, that's awesome. This is funny. If you guys are, if you're not cracking up on the sideline dialogue, it's funny. It's awesome.
Oh yeah.
Oh my goodness.
I wanted to say another point on the distribution, you know, part or whatever. Like, I kind of think it's really interesting when, you know, like one of the things that attracted me to craft beer in the first place was the fact that, you know, it was the community that was really strong, you know, and that had to do with, you know, distribution played a huge part in that too. And when craft beer was starting out, you know, in like the late 80s, early 90s, like when Stone was starting up, and then also Alesmith, you know, on the West Coast, it was to the point where, you know, Stone and Alesmith, when they were starting up, they didn't have a wide distribution. I mean, these were guys, you know, even Six Point, you know, down in New York, it was the same thing where, you know, these guys were like, they, you know, got together, put money together, got a van, and they would make as many, you know, barrels as they could, throw them in the van and go around and deliver it themselves. And even with Stone Brewery or Stone Brewing Company, like they couldn't. I'm making a serious point right now.
Bring it home, Marlon. Bring it home. You can do it.
All right.
Hey, yeah. Eric, shut up, Eric, for just a second. All right. Let us get through.
It's all good, man. I love humor. Okay, I got to catch up on that in a second. I'm going to lose myself. But, you know, basically, I just, you know, I think that is the heart of craft craft brewing, is the tightness of the community, and the fact that, you know, in order for Stone to, you know, Stone would never be where they're at had it not been for Stone and Alesmith getting together and distributing each other's beers together, so they had a wider distribution. I mean, that was absolutely huge. And these are breweries that are supposed to be competing against each other. But I mean, they had to come together in that kind of way. And there's also a lot of different breweries too that don't have a wide distribution, but it kind of, you know, has this life of its own in the sense that you have to travel. You have to go travel, you know, to this brewery in order to go try their stuff. And I think that's absolutely amazing, you know.
Right. Well, I was going to say, I'm a big Surly fan, Surly Brewing. I'm basically a fanboy. I wear their hats all the time. I'm, you know, always talking about it. Whenever I do a beer swap with somebody, Jonah knows this, I'll send them Surly. I love the stuff. And I think part of the reason why is because that the story behind how they came about, the fact that they kind of are trying to remain kind of a community type of brewery, even though they're trying to distribute right now, I think Chicago, Iowa, Wisconsin, they're trying to go out of state, they're trying to grow, but they have a huge cult organic following behind them. So I totally agree with what you're saying, Marlon.
Okay, awesome.
Is this how we are supposed to end the show? We out have to get six pack hop slam hats on, or
this just isn't any or hat. Glass. This is a hop. Yes, seriously. Yeah, yes. All right. Hey, Haley Lynn, thanks for stopping in. Good to see you, man. Every Tuesday at 9 p.m., you know where to find us. Thanks. It's 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Hey, by the way, again, folks, great show. Leland Best, check him out, Blab Nation. You want to learn all things marketing, him and John Prakod. Awesome, guys. Thanks so much for stopping in.
Yeah. Any favorite styles before we go out here? Or?
I don't know. For me, I'm trying to expand my palate, but I still just keep going back to IPAs. I mean, give me a nice hoppy IPA that has a good balance to it. I mean, Hop Slam is the perfect example. But I am trying to, I mean, we did a show a couple weeks ago about sours, and I definitely want to try some more. Saison.
Have you tried any I do love Jolly Pumpkin stuff yet? Their stuff's
Jolly Pumpkin, no, I haven't.
Look out for their beers, man. Fantastic brewery. Fantastic. I think you'll really like this
stuff. Dude, the sideline dialogue in itself is priceless, folks. If you just watch this show on replay, it's just I'm like, yes.
they need to include the chat stream in the replay. They really do.
Oh my god, that would be awesome.
I'm not gonna say out loud everything that comes up in it. But you can't, somebody
you
should have.
Dan, I gotta ask you a question.
Yeah.
This is the second time I see you in this blab. Like, are you wearing a backpack?
No, I got suspenders on, man.
Oh, okay. Check I was this. Gonna ask. I was like, where are you going, man? I've never seen ones that look like that because it curves around the side like this.
Yeah, yeah.
So I was like, it could be a gun going all the time. Like, it's crazy. It's like
the real reason behind the receiver.
I've seen him come down the front like this, but I never seen him go like this.
The real reason for the suspenders is he got lost 30 pounds this summer. Look,
check my pants. All right. Nice. Hey, that's good, man. For liking craft beer, that's awesome.
Well, yeah. I haven't had a whole lot of beer this summer, but I'm starting. You know what? I'm not getting rid of these pants. I'm going to put them in craft probably in the next month.
That's craft beer has been my nemesis. I make great strides in my cycling, and every Tuesday night comes, I'm like, oh crap.
I wanted to ask Gunner too. Gunner, where are you out of?
Rochester, Minnesota.
Okay, I was wondering if you might have been maybe in Oregon. I heard there's an awesome place, like a cycling place, where you. You go through this long trip and maybe you've heard of it and you stop off and they like tune your cycle up or whatever. And then you get to drink craft beer. They have like a bar there and stuff like that. I thought that was pretty sweet.
Oh, nice. That would be awesome.
That's awesome. Yeah.
I should pack my bike shop people if they could get some beers going there. Yeah. That's awesome.
Absolutely. Marlon, you and Tommy Crowder, like, you guys would be peas in the pod. Like, Tommy Crowder, he's in the backdrop. He's hanging out. He's Mr. He's our vapor at large. He's always like,
guys, man. Okay. That might be one of the best impressions I've heard of Tommy ever so far.
He's like,
I've
chatted
with Tommy
a couple times. He's like, I'm vaping, dude. What's up? What's up? Got the juice, man. Burp, burp, burp,
burp. I'm waiting for my new juices to come in, man. I'm stoked.
You get him. He's rolling on the floor right now. Like, that's the problem. We need to like make like these other sidebars for people to come in and like, you know, chime in. This is the funny part about it.
I'm going to drop off and let Tommy jump on for a bit and just relax and take a breathe. I've been laughing too hard.
Let's get Tommy on here.
Come on, Tommy. Are you coming on, Tommy?
I think he is. All right, Dan. Hey, good to see you, man. All right, take off your jetpack.
Got the Rocketeer up in the house.
Oh, my God. Marlon, that is – All right, come on, Tommy. You got an open chair. Where are you, dude? Come on. He's like, oh my God, Marlon, that was hilarious. Are you wearing a backpack? I almost like fell off my. It's just there's never a dull moment here. I can't, guys. My kids are going. Sorry, Eric. Come on, you need to jump in, Eric. He's here he comes. All right, perfect. Yeah. Good news. Oh my God. He'll jump in. Look at this. All right. Hey, Leanne. Good to see you. What's up?
What's up with your pictures? Come on, guys. It's Fat Tuesday. F&A. Let's go. Can you hear me?
We can totally hear you. You are, man. What's up, Eric?
I'm fired up. It's Fat Tuesday.
I see that.
And I was late. Dan, did you know he's growing his beard into suspenders for his pants to save money so he can buy more craft beer?
Oh my God.
And it has been shown in studies, feces found in beards, all these girls that like beards, kissing somebody's butt because they rub it and they don't wash their hands. True story.
Oh my God.
Eric.
Nobody.
God, so the Super Bowl, who was not excited about the Super Bowl?
I just did not expect it to go that way. I'll tell you that.
Oh, my God.
I expected it. You know why? Did you not see my Periscope with my prayer to Almighty God who made the mountains from 12,000 feet 2 hours before? That's what kicked it over the top, my friend. I'm bald. I'm gray. I'm old.
Someone asked you if you were bald?
Come on, Dan. Seriously. I don't even have a beer. I went to the fridge and I'm like, oh, God, I don't even have a beer, so I could drink some gin.
There you go.
Nicole would be psyched. That's awesome.
On my head.
She'd yell over that.
Anyway.
Have you tried
the Super Bowl? That is awesome.
So, Eric, have you tried Hop Slam?
No. No, I have not. Could you pour me one?
Yeah.
I did see you unveil the glass. That thing is badass.
It's the sickest.
Yeah, no. Hey, Marlon, where'd you get that, by the way?
I got this at this place down here called Magic Tree. They and also Vintage State, the old place I used to work at that I was telling you about. They do like glass inclusives all the time. So I got almost the same style glass tube by God damn it. They do the 12 Dogs of Christmas. What the fuck are they called? I can't remember. They're in Ohio here somewhere. Their beers are all right. But I got
so nobody commented on my very poignant observation in the thing about Smokey and the Bandit. Do you remember what the whole theme of Smokey and the Bandit was?
Yeah, it was smelling Coors beer.
Right. And so when you're talking about Breckenridge Brewery and some of these other, you know, craft breweries, you know, now they're going to have wider distribution, but won't that take away the mystique and kind of the scarcity? Isn't that what we love about craft beer, is that there's some kind of scarcity to it? That's got to be something to it that you can't quite get it, right?
That was kind of my point.
It is and it isn't. I mean, the scarcity does kind of add to it. But on the other hand, if more people can get it, isn't that better? I mean, you know, if you could get a beer that I have here, wouldn't that make you happy?
See, I want to say like yes and no at the same time.
Right. Yes, that's exactly what I want to say. Did you I look know, at him?
Well, here's the thing too, you know, is I like this. I like the fact that here's the thing. We talk about building community again, okay? There is such a thing as trading. Okay, that I think is awesome. Like keep it that way. It works beautifully. And it's great if you've never traded before, you have to get into it. It's amazing. You could have someone on the West Coast and they'll, you work out a deal. I'll trade you this for this. And then when your box arrives, they'll throw in some extra shit in there that, you know, you're like, holy crap, what the hell is this? You know, you didn't have to do this. And it's just, it's awesome. And I just want to keep it that way. I think it's great. It kind of gives you a reason to go travel to. I love that aspect of it. I think it's fantastic. The fact that, you know, you just snap your fingers and you just get it. You can get it anywhere. I love that craft brewing is not that way, that they don't follow, you know, the same models as every other corporation out there. I love that. I don't even want it to turn into that. You know, I call me a fucking purist. I don't care. But, you know, that's
fucking
the way I
purist.
Like,
that's why we love you. Have I not been talking about this app now for going on over 2.5-3 months? We need an app that allows that to untapped. Weren't they going to be doing something like that? Or they?
There is a beer advocate. I mean, an app now. That's what people trade on. Beer advocate. You know, I know.
Beer. Hold on. You got to get that on right now.
Yeah, beer. Go to beer advocate. That is like most people trade on that. Man, I know dudes that trade a ton of shit on that. They get crazy stuff.
My fear with Beer Advocate, because I think I used to troll the boards there, and then Reddit has a beer sharing board. But my fear is getting in touch with someone that's going to send you crap and then steal your beer or send you something counterfeit. Or, you know, you hear stories about somebody taking a bottle and filling it up with garbage and then sending it to you thinking that right. And you're not going to know until you get it. And even then, you may not know.
Well, I can tell you what you're going to get with the beer that I send you. It's it'll be a little foamy. But you can
a lot of dudes on there, if I'm not mistaken, I want to say they have like ratings and people can comment and stuff like that. So you can actually see who is, you know, a good and well-trusted trader on there, you know? You know, there's different things like that.
Yeah. It's like couch surfing or VRBO or what's that other one where you rent the houses, you rate people. And, you know, if you want to take on a chance on somebody that hasn't been rated, then you don't trade with them. But if you've got somebody with a high rating, then absolutely. Why wouldn't you want to trade with them?
Yeah, absolutely. And Don's chiming in. He said trade it on BA. Once you get a few contacts in a few areas, you're all set. You know, so he said usually extras you get trades are as good as the beers you trade for. And I would believe that.
Right.
It's awesome.
Which is awesome. Yeah. Love getting other people's homebrews. I got to send some of my homebrew out too eventually to people.
That would be awesome. What do you brew?
I've brewed a couple of IPAs, a couple of American pale ales. Lately, I've been brewing gluten-free beers because I have some people that I know that are celiac.
Right.
So I'm doing kind of the sorghum. I've been doing extracts. So
I've actually given up gluten for Lent. I'm going 100% gluten for Lent.
Wow. You're going 100% gluten-free or just eating gluten?
All gluten.
100%.
I'm not.
Okay. I'm not smoking. I was like, shit, he's a rebel, man.
Sex with dirty girls, and now probably I'm protected. Who knows? I'm just really going to give up all safety for Lent.
Right.
Oh, all good common sense.
You know what's crazy?
Because I wouldn't mind hearing from Donald, but listen, my time is coming short here, gentlemen. I've got next week, and then that's it for a little while. I'll be taking off for 3 months, and hopefully we'll be able to chime in every once in a while, but probably going to be difficult. It's for your freedom to drink beer whenever you want, my friend. So I'll be here next week. I hope I'm going to be working, and then I'm going to try to make a bike chat, Jonah. Try to get a hold of those two friends of mine, Spencer and then Sonia Looney.
I already did. It's in the works. We'll talk about that at the end of the show.
Both of them are fantastic. Make sure Spencer talks about his, because he's the one that set up the International Fat Tire Festival or Fat Tire Championships in Wilmington. And also he does this floating with the raft deal between the islands. And I think that's going to be more adventure biking. I think that's going to take off. Well, all right, I'll let somebody else get in here. Hello, everybody up into the gallery. Goodbye. I'm sorry for my ridiculousness. I can't help. Remember, it's tomorrow, so get it all out of your system.
Hell yeah.
Yeah.
Miller, I wanted to say, Gunner, too, man, it's crazy how far extract has come. Like, it's unbelievable. Extract has gotten really, really, really good, you know, when brewing.
I tend to brew extract because it's easier.
Right.
But I got to get my my brew in a bag or all grain.
Brew in a bag, I think, is the best way to go, you know.
Yeah.
Just do a nice solid 5-gallon batch. You know, you're good.
Right. Hey, guys, we're way past the top of the hour. I wanted to thank everyone for tuning in. Next week's show, I just put the link here if anyone wants to subscribe. And yeah, please don't stop on my account, but you know, I'm gonna have to jump out here. Next week's show, we're gonna be interviewing the co-founder of, it's kind of an interesting thing, it's called Regrained. It's a energy bar that they use the spent grains from breweries to make their energy bar. So I'm kind of excited. It could actually cross over into the bike chat world. We'll see. Hopefully, we'll see what he's doing. I think he's got some sort of Kickstarter or Indiegogo campaign going. Either that or it's done. I don't remember exactly, but we'll be talking to him about what he's got. And then also, again, like we said, Thursday is bike chat. We got
bike.
Who is it? It's bike. Right? Yeah. Let me get that link up.
Bike Gab. Yeah, they make custom leather. Leather goods and cycling accessories. So that'll be their nice Kickstarter. Again, Eric X asked the question. Is it Regrained? That is what you're talking about next week. Regrained.
Regrained. Yeah.
Regrained.
That's it. Yeah. Awesome. Yep. I might even have their link here somewhere.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's kind of interesting. I mean, you know. Supposedly spent grains still have a lot of nutrients and stuff in it, at least from what I've read. So they might be onto something, kind of an extra use for the spent grains after you brew some beer. So
now they do have a couple different flavors, by the way. I was on the website. I was taking a look at that. Now, they're trying to send some samples. Is that what I understand? So we can try these things before we review them.
Hopefully get some before the show, but they said that they'd be sending a couple to us. So hopefully we get them. If not, we'll just talk to them and maybe pretend we're eating them. I don't know.
Seriously. We'll break out some of your honey stinger stash.
Yeah. We'll say, oh, these are delicious. No. it does sound like it's a really great concept. At least, there is a lot of waste in brewing beer, especially if you're doing all grain. With all that spent grain, I know a lot of people will bake bread after they brew a batch of beer, which is one way to do it. So, who knows?
I told for anyone in here that likes to vape too, I recommended to this one company that I buy juice from that I want hop flavored juice.
How awesome would that be? There you go. That
would be awesome. I want to vape hops all day.
Have you ever had the there's a hop candy that you can get.
Yeah. Yep.
That is good stuff.
I even tried homemade hop candy, which was even better. It was amazing.
Nice.
Yeah. One lady used to make that. It was great.
That must have been an intensive process to make homemade hop candy.
Yeah.
Right.
I think she was drunk in the process, but it went all right, though. You know? It was good. Good stuff.
That makes the time go by faster.
All right. Same with brewing, right? You gotta drink homebrew while you're brewing.
You gotta have a homebrew while you're brewing.
Absolutely.
I'm gonna have to jump out. I'm gonna stop the recording. But go ahead and feel free to continue chatting on. Again, we have the sock giveaway that we will announce next week. Anyone that's tweeted out to the little bird, or joined the newsletter, or joined the Facebook group, we'll get an entry into for each one of those. So you have a possibility of three entries for the show. That'll go into a spreadsheet, and then we'll do a random number draw to figure out the winner. And Surly Brewing, again, once again, I'm a fanboy. So
how do we do that? Spread.
So tweet out. Did you tweet out to your friends? If you tweet out for the show, that's one entry. Then if you join.
I just did.
Okay. So that's one. Facebook group. If you join that, here's the link to the Facebook group.
Hey, stop giving them the links. I already did all three, and I don't need any more competitors.
Too late. Too late.
The Facebook group. And then finally, our newsletter mail list for Craft Beer Blab.
I like Dan's comment. Just get drunk on the blab.
That would be awesome.
It was like
really good at that.
Well, it's like one of our viewers. I think it was like last week. They're like, wow, Jonah's being like awfully quiet. Like, what's up? I was just like sitting there, not saying anything. I can't afford to get. Dan says I can't afford to get drunk on this beer. Not fair.
10%. That's some high tolerance then.
10%.
I had Oh man, I had before I came home here. I had a fucking hop slam, and then I had a high res, which was awesome.
And actually, another my list is High Lie. Have you had a High Lie from who's that? Cigar City?
No, I haven't got to try a whole bunch of Cigar City stuff.
Yeah, see, that's another one that's on my list of two tries. But anyway, I gotta go. I'm gonna pause recording, and you guys keep chatting on. Thanks a lot for tuning in.